Hello everyone. My name's George Heritage. I work for Cambridge Assessment English in the Madrid office. Welcome to today's session, looking at the burning question on everyone's minds. Will we be in class this year? Well, Helen Allen, our digital pedagogy lead, works on digital language teaching, learning and training here at Cambridge English. And she's going to be sharing practical ideas for planning for any situation in school, online, remote learning, somewhere in between, I imagine. Like most of you, we're all working from home, but we're aiming to give you the best experience we can. We're relying on our home wireless, so please bear with us if we have any issues. During the webinar, you'll need to be able to use the chat box on the right-hand side of the screen. Chat box for any comments. Please use the Q&A box for any questions directed to Helen. We'll have some questions, we'll save some questions for the Q&A session at the end, so don't worry if your question isn't answered right away. And we will be asking you to take part in a couple of polls during the session, so keep your eyes out for those. We will also be issuing you all with a certificate at the end of the session, and certificate and a link to the recording will be sent to you after the session. So off you go, Helen.
Lovely. Thank you very much, George. It's just coming to the end of a really beautiful afternoon where I am in the UK. So I'm hoping that you're all also having a nice day or evening or early morning, wherever you are in the world. So yes, we're going to explore how we can manage planning in these very uncertain times. And this session is aimed at primary and secondary teachers, but it doesn't really matter what age group or level you teach. There will be some ideas that you can use in any teaching context. Okay, so I'm going to start off with a poll. I'd like to start by finding out how you will be teaching your classes this term. Are you fully face-to-face? Will you be with your students in class? Are you fully online? Are you part face-to-face and part online? Do you have some students face-to-face with some other students joining you live online from their homes? Do you have some students face-to-face with others working online at home independently? Are you not at all sure how you're going to be teaching, or something else? If it's something else, tell me in the chat there. But otherwise, please fill in the poll here and tell us how you're teaching your main classes this term, or how you're expecting to have to teach this term. I'll just give you a second there. We know that teachers around the world are really having to adapt to this unusual situation that we find ourselves in. And the purpose of this session is really to look at ways that we can plan our lessons so that we can easily adapt to any situation. So let's have a look at the result of the poll there, Natasha. Wow, okay. So 40% of you are expecting to teach fully online. Some of you are fully face-to-face, about 15% of you all face-to-face. 18% part face-to-face, part online. And then the tricky ones, so some of you are expecting about sort of 9% and 4% are expecting to have classes where you've got some people face-to-face in front of you and some people at home as well. So a real mixture there. I can see 11% of you are still unsure. And I'm just going to have a quick look. That's lovely. I'm just trying to open the chat box, but it won't open for me at the moment. Here we go. No, I can't open the chat at the moment. Sorry. I'll try and look at that later. Okay, so a vast range of different situations. And we know as well that whatever we've got in front of us now, we may have to change really quickly and accommodate a new style of working. So let's have a little think about that. Rather than think about offline and online teaching, we're going to think about what can be done synchronously and asynchronously today. So by synchronous learning, we mean learning that takes place in real time with the teacher and the learners together in the classroom or in a virtual classroom. And by asynchronous learning, we mean learning that takes place independently in the learner's own time, whether that's done again on a computer or not. After we've looked at those, we'll think about how we can plan for these different kinds of tasks. And then planning for the worst case scenario, which probably is no synchronous contact with our learners at all. So if we think about what can be done well asynchronously and continue to plan for asynchronous learning, even if we're planning for a face-to-face context at the same time, then going back online will be much, much easier. And plus, learners will build some of the independence that they need to manage their learning online sufficiently well to achieve their learning outcomes. It's a skill that is just an important skill. It's something that will benefit learners throughout their school lives and their working lives too. And plus, if we plan appropriately, we won't have to rewrite lessons. And I know that's something on a lot of people's minds, is how long it's taking to teach in this new context or these different contexts. So we can simply use what we've already created, and with a little adaptation, we can make it work. And live lessons then can focus on just the things that we think can be done best in that synchronous face-to-face environment. So let's have a little think about which activities you think learners can do well in their own time outside of live lessons. So I'd like you to look at this list of activities here. Natasha, can you open up the poll? So this is a choose multiple poll. So you can choose as many of these as you like. Can you tell me which of these activities you think learners can do well asynchronously without a teacher? Goal setting, input, collaborative practice, individual practice, project work, learner training input or learner training practice, community building, monitoring of learning, and feedback. Have a little look. Select all the activities you think can be done well asynchronously. Even if you don't normally choose to do them asynchronously, which ones do you think we can do well? Just give you a moment. Okay, Natasha, would you like to show us the results of that one? Okay, so it's no surprise here. 75% of you think individual practice can be done well asynchronously. And I would definitely agree with you there. Other high scoring ones, project work, 68% of you think that can be done well. Yep. Goal setting, quite possibly, yes. Learner training practice, depending on how it's delivered, yes. And the ones that we think can be done less well online would be community building, so only 22% of you think that can be done well asynchronously. Input, also 25% of you think that can be done well asynchronously. So there's a large percentage of you there thinking that input is probably best done in some kind of synchronous form. Okay, fantastic. We're going to go on and have a little look at the next slide. So it really does depend on your teaching context and the type of learners that you have. But I'd suggest that it's possible for the things on the left of this table to be done well asynchronously. So let's plan to do some of these asynchronously in our courses, even if we're teaching face-to-face, to help learners develop the skills they need to work independently and to easily use materials when they're in that environment learning on their own. And that leaves precious time that we have in live lessons when we can get everybody into a classroom or into an online classroom for things like collaborative practice, a bit of learner training input, and really importantly, some community building as well. And obviously like things like pastoral support and checking in and making sure that everyone's okay as well is important in that synchronous environment. So we're going to look more closely at how we can plan for asynchronous activities so that they work effectively. So the first thing is to determine what materials you'll be using. Is it a course book or an ebook? Is there an electronic workbook or just a paper one? Will learners have their own copy? And will they have access to these if they're working from home? Will you be using online materials that are already made, your own worksheets, or a mixture of all of those things? So that's resources, but also you need to find out what devices your learners have access to and how often they have access to them. Once you know those things, you can determine how best to stay in contact and share resources with your class. So it's a really good idea to use an LMS, that's a learning management system. You can share resources and links, you can set assignments, create quizzes, record learner progress often, and generally keep in touch with learners, and it's all in one place. I mean, that's the advantage of a learning management system, it's all in one place. Plus, parents can often access what their children are doing in that environment too. Examples of free LMSs you might like to use are things like Google Classroom and Edmodo. Or you might prefer to use something like a social messaging tool, such as WhatsApp, to communicate with learners and parents. They'll probably see your messages faster that way, so it might be easier. And then use something like Google Docs to share documents. But it's really important that you look at and follow your school's policy on what tools you and your learners can use and what you can share within those tools. And I'm sure you'll agree that actually, really, the fewer tools you use, the better, because too many tools can be overwhelming for us as teachers in the first place, and also for our learners and their parents. So using just one or two or maybe three tools consistently helps everyone get into a really good habit of using them, and perhaps later on you can introduce new things once everyone's feeling confident. And of course, there may be learners in your class who don't have access to technology and who need to receive worksheets or correspondence on paper. And knowing this in advance means that they won't miss out on their schoolwork. So now that we know how we're going to keep in touch with our learners, then we can think about lessons and planning. So I've got some examples from primary and secondary here. If you're a primary teacher introducing vocabulary describing, for example, different illnesses like here, toothache, stomachache, that kind of thing, you might record yourself miming the different illnesses and saying what they are in English, maybe repeating them a few times and encouraging learners to repeat what you're saying. If you're a secondary teacher introducing have got in the context of a big family, you might record yourself telling students who's in the family, like I've got two brothers, a daughter, etc., before then clarifying the form of the structure. And on both occasions in that video, you can tell learners what the learning objective of the lesson or the series of lessons is. So by asking learners to watch video at home before a lesson or outside a lesson, you're giving them control over when they watch it, how they watch it, how many times they watch it. And you can then review it in class and provide lots of time for practice with you there to support them, whether that's online or face-to-face. So there are lots of benefits. And if learners get into the habit of working in this way on your face-to-face course, they'll easily be able to do the same when you have to go online fully. And it also works for situations for those of you who will have some students in the classroom and some students at home joining in or working on their own. So I'm sure many of you have actually made videos for your students over the past months. And if you've got any tips or advice about how to record them or integrate them into your lessons successfully, do share your ideas in the chat box. We can all learn from each other. So do add your ideas there while you're listening if you'd like to. And here you can see some different kinds of videos. The presenting illnesses or looking at have got, presenting have got. So here you can see a teacher miming in a video. You can see a mini whiteboard, a toy, a written handout and slides. And if you're a primary teacher, maybe using a puppet or two to present language is a great way of engaging your class and getting their attention. Note that in two of these images, the toy and the written handout, we can only hear the teacher and not see them. So if you don't want to appear on camera, if you don't want to have your face on camera, there are ways around this. You don't have to have your face up there. It can just be your voice, for example. So one tip for creating a video is to imagine that you're talking directly to your class as you do in a face-to-face lesson. And if you make a mistake, if you trip up over a word or something or hesitate, don't stop the recording and start again. This happens all the time in class. It's natural use of language. There's no need to spend hours perfecting your videos. Two, keep your videos short and as engaging as possible. So no more than a couple of minutes for primary and maybe like 5 minutes maximum for secondary. If it's short and simple, and ask learners questions as you're explaining language, or ask them to repeat words or sentences so they're not just listening passively. And a series of short videos is better than a great big long one, in my opinion anyway. 3, create a task for learners to do after watching the video. And this might be something like an online quiz, so you can see who's completed it and how well they've understood the language or the thing that you're trying to learn. By reviewing this information, you can quickly spot any problems and address them in your next lesson or maybe through another video. And 4, so this is the problem area. If you have learners that will struggle to work independently, or you don't think that they'll watch a video at home for homework, use this as an opportunity for learner training. So maybe get them to watch the video in your class and complete the task in your online class or your face-to-face class. Play the video for them or get them to watch it on individual devices with headphones. Try and monitor and support learners and help them understand what they're supposed to be doing and why and how to do it. And hopefully once they've got into the swing of that, once they've got a habit established, they'll be able to do that at home more easily, more readily. So I'd like to look at what tips you've got in the chat. And I'm just trying to get the chat box to appear on my screen. But I'm having a little problem doing that. Can you just hold on with me for a second?
Google Classroom has proved popular. Nelson's mentioned Fire Thank Alpaca. You. Fire Alpaca and my drawing skills, which I've never heard of, but sounds great. A Power Record, I suppose. Edmodo has popped up a few times in Edpuzzle. Yeah.
Lovely. Okay, thank you, George. You might have to do that again because I can't actually see the chat box for some reason. I don't know why.
With the chat as well, so I'll keep it.
Okay, lovely. Okay, so let's move on. So for creating videos, like you said, we've got lots of ideas here as well. So you can use a webcam or the camera on your phone, video conferencing software if you've got a record feature, and tools like Screencast-O-Matic or Educreations, which record what you've got on your screen and your voice at the same time. So you can talk about a photo or a drawing or some slides or a handout. And these videos are saved in the cloud and then you share a link with your learners. And again, it's important to ensure that's done securely. For a quiz or a survey to help understand what students have learnt from the input, you can again use an LMS or a tool like learning apps where you can create matching tasks or gap fill activities or multiple choice questions, that kind of thing. You can also use polling tools like Mentimeter. So for individual practice or skills work, as you said earlier in the poll, I mean, this is like one area that really learners can do this at home. There's lots of different things they can use to do this at home. They can do practice tasks in their course book, their workbook, and you can check answers in the next lesson. Or if you're using an LMS that comes with your course book, you can see the tasks that they're doing. They can complete them. They can get immediate feedback as well in that environment. Or alternatively, you can source practice tasks online or use web tools or apps to create your own, and then share the links in your LMS or whatever means you are using to communicate with your learners. So this is an example using learning apps. Learning apps is a free tool. You can see a closed text here, practicing have got for our secondary class. And learners just type in the words and they get instant feedback about what's right or wrong. And if you create a class within this tool, you can also see what they're getting right and wrong. So it's just an example. Another example here for individual practice, for repeated practice and for spaced learning, because it actually delivers things back to you if you haven't learned them. You can set tasks in a tool like Quizlet, as shown here. And learners can review language through tasks and games with flashcards, which you create or which you can choose from the ones that are already created within the tool. And it is, with things like Quizlet, it's really nice if you can get learners to create their own practice tasks. That means they have more control over their learning, they think more deeply about the language, they get lots of practice by using their classmates' tasks as well, because you can share them around. The only thing with that is with Quizlet, they would have to register. So learners or their parents would have to register for you to be able to do that, but not on learning apps. Okie doke. So moving on to freer oral and written practice, because this can also be done asynchronously, as can project work as well. So many of you will have set such work for learners to complete in their own time. Writing homework is very common, but speaking homework and project work maybe is less so, although in the poll you did say the project work could be done well asynchronously. So if I was a new teacher who wanted to do this for the first time, what tips would you give me? What have you learned from your experiences so far? I'd love to hear your ideas, so do pop them in the chat box and George will help us pick them out in a minute. What tips would you give me for setting speaking tasks or project work for learners to complete in their own time asynchronously at home? Is there anything coming up there, George?
Flipgrid's popping up a lot.
Yeah.
Providing a model to the students before they have to do it, I think,
most important
definitely. At various
That's
levels,
really
especially
important.
Lower levels, giving them as much scaffolding as possible.
Lovely. Okay. So let's have a little cup of examples here.
SoundCloud. Another
one. SoundCloud. So SoundCloud's great. And Vocaroo is another example of a speech audio recorder. So in terms of tools, learners can share their work on your learning management system. They can use a tool like Vocaroo or something like SoundCloud to record themselves and share the link on the LMS for you and maybe for other people to hear. So our primary learners, for example, could record themselves describing a person in a picture or on a slide, and a classmate then listens and identifies who it is in the picture. Or they could maybe read a story to you or tell you something about their daily lives, maybe to use the present simple. Secondary learners could do something like describe their family or maybe tell an anecdote about a family member, which others respond to with a follow-up question. And there are benefits to asking learners to work in this way, to record themselves speaking. It gives them something they don't often have, which is a chance to hear themselves and reflect on their skills, to reflect on what they think is working and what they need to improve. So they can re-record it if they're not happy, they can make improvements. If they can hear their classmates' recordings, they can learn from their peers too. Again, it is actually really very important for security to follow your school policy and ensure that you're allowed to share audio and video of your learners speaking before you do it. It's a very important point here on security and data. So that's speaking. Writing, learners can share their written work in maybe Word or take a photo of handwritten work. That's a nice idea because it gets them off the screen, so they get onto paper and writing and just take a photo to share, and they can upload that to the LMS too. For project work, they can use tools like ThingLink. It's a board, and you can add images, video, text, audio, and links on maybe a topic of interest, something like that. And you'll notice here that we've included Padlet for all of these things. So Padlet is an online notice board where learners can add text, images, links, documents, they can record their voice. It's a really versatile tool. And as we don't want to overwhelm learners and parents with too many tools, using this one for lots of different things actually can be really useful. And they get into the swing of it, they get used to the type of tool, and it's a really lovely tool to use. The thing with Padlet is you only get 3 free boards, but these can be recycled. You can use them again and again, and you can set them importantly to private to protect your students' data. All right, let's have a little look on the next one. This is what you were just mentioning from the chat before, George. So it's really important to help learners have a good chance of success and also the best chance of understanding or recognizing their success as well. And this helps train learners to become more independent and also to be more confident about what they've done and to understand why it's good. The first thing is to make the learning objective clear, so learners know what they're trying to achieve. Then provide them with a model so they know what they've got to do. We'd mentioned that just a moment ago. You can provide them with a set of clear stages so that they know how to complete the task. And that might include maybe a video tutorial or instructions on how to use a digital tool like Padlet. You can create that yourself, or you can use the videos that are available on websites as well. There are plenty of instructional videos that you can share the links with your learners. And this is an example of learner training, which can be done asynchronously. Finally, it's important to provide assessment criteria so that learners can self-assess and identify what they did well and what they need to remember to do better the next time. And then ask them to complete a self-assessment task, maybe using a poll or a quiz tool to identify how well they or their partner met each of those criteria. And this can be done, and it's important to remember as well, especially with this online environment, you know, there's no harm in doing that kind of analysis, that reflection in L1, if that's more useful for you and your learners, if it gives you more information or it's easier to express what you're doing. Okay, so monitoring and feedback. This is our next asynchronous task that we can probably do quite well. So let's think about how we, the teachers, can monitor work that's completed asynchronously and provide feedback asynchronously, so not in an online or face-to-face class. Do share your ideas in the chat. So George, I'm going to ask if you can see anything coming up in that chat.
We're still answering the last question, so give it a second.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's great. This
it is really nice.
When this is the thing, you know, so if we've all been in this situation, everybody's in a different context, and there's so much information to share and so many great ideas that we can learn from other teachers who've been in similar or different contexts. And this is the real advantage of an event like this.
Yeah.
We have teachers from across the world who can share their ideas.
Feedback-wise, we've got Vocaroo, yeah. Flipgrid, Google Docs, a phone call, pretty old school, but definitely does the job. Giving video feedback. I think you can do that really easily on Flipgrid. It's really nice. And there are built-in ways of giving feedback on Flipgrid once the candidate sent you a video.
Yeah, that's right. And a phone call, or even sort of like a one-to-one video call, if it's not possible to get all your class into an online class, I mean, that can have a really significant impact on engagement, because it shows the learner that you're interested in their achievements, and it helps them to focus and understand where it is that they maybe need to do some work. So I think, you know, phone calls and one-to-one and small group tutorials definitely have a place if you are able to do those with your learners as well. Okay, so monitoring and feedback. So you can monitor learning by looking at the results of online quizzes and tasks and any oral or written output. So we can also look at learners' own assessments as well to see how they feel about their learning. And we can use that information to make decisions about what to do next. We can provide feedback to learners orally in video or audio recordings, or in writing, and we can share it on our LMS or in a private social group or via email or telephone, like we just said. And feedback can be to the whole class or groups. You can ask learners to maybe reply to your feedback and correct common errors. But personal feedback has its place too. So providing personal feedback to each individual learner can be quite important. Although you may choose not to do that for every single task, because quite frankly, you're probably not going to have the time to be able to do that. So using a mixture of things like quizzes where it gives automatic feedback, and selecting a few learners each time when you have more in-depth feedback to give, means that every learner receives feedback over a series of lessons. And that's a really important thing to think about, is your time as well as the kind of feedback that you're giving. And of course, feedback doesn't just come from the teacher. Another way of saving time or helping that process is to use peer feedback and self-assessment. We can ask learners to complete regular reflection tasks to encourage them to think about the feedback that they have received. We can ask them to complete a worksheet or use a tool like a survey tool like Google Forms or a poll tool like Mentimeter to think about what they did well and what they need to work on. And again, don't be afraid to use L1 if that's okay in your context and it's helpful for learners to do that. I don't see any problem in doing that at all. Okay, so we can plan to do the things on the left asynchronously without a teacher, even if we can do them in a face-to-face context. Because then if we have to suddenly move fully online, it'll be much easier for both us and our learners. Learners, like I said before, will probably benefit from becoming more independent in their learning. And we can also benefit from being able to assess all of our learners to see all of that content on the screen, rather than just with the people who've got their hands up in a class. And if we have the luxury of being in class with our learners, it's easier to add what we do as teachers back into asynchronous tasks like this than it is to get classroom activities online for asynchronous learning. So then let's turn our attention to the synchronous tasks and consider how we can plan them so that they work face-to-face and online or both at the same time. So community building. This is about getting learners to feel they're part of a community where they're respected and supported and valued. The first thing we can do is obviously model good behaviours ourselves, and we can work with a class to set rules that, you know, they're more likely to do good behaviour if they've created some of the rules for themselves. They're more likely to follow them. We can make sure we try to get to know our learners as much as possible. And that, I guess that's really important at this time of the year. If you're starting a school year now and you haven't taught those learners before, it's really important to establish a relationship between you and the learners, but also between the learners as well. We can encourage them to show interest in each other's lives. We can do get to know you activities. We can encourage them to respond to each other and ask and answer questions and give them time to share things that they want to share at the beginning of the or the end of the lesson. And that face-to-face time, whether that's online or in a face-to-face classroom, is really important, especially if there's a lot of online learning going on. Really try and maximize that class time to build the community. It also means making sure that all learners feel part of a lesson. So not just nominating learners to speak who are physically in front of us, but if we have people watching live online, we also nominate those people in the online environment. Not just looking at those learners in front of us, but making sure we look at the camera so that we're trying to make eye contact with those people who are remote, who are online, even if they're not physically there. Okay, collaborative practice. This in general can be planned in much the same way for a physical classroom or for breakout rooms in an online class. So for example, primary learners can do maybe a picture dictation using part of a picture like this, with one learner describing and then their partner drawing. Or secondary learners can ask and answer questions using have got to complete a table like this, for example. One of the face-to-face issues, of course, is social distancing and the use of masks. So these can make pair and group work much more challenging as learners can't communicate as easily. So we may need to reduce the amount of peer checking that we do perhaps, or maybe alternate, do pair work, but alternate between pairs in front of the whole class, if you can do that, if they're confident enough, so that everyone can kind of practice doing that communicative work and hear each other as well, so not all of the class shouting, and at an appropriate distance. So that's quite important if you're socially distancing. Or of course, you can, even in the face-to-face class, you can use online breakout rooms where learners can interact with each other online, and that allows them to do it in a much sort of quieter way. You don't want them shouting out loud, and it allows them to collaborate or communicate with each other. For other tasks, like brainstorming or giving answers to tasks, sharing ideas and opinions that we usually do orally in a face-to-face class, we can use collaborative tools like Padlet, Mentimeter, the forum on your LMS. As I just mentioned before, the advantage of these ways of doing it means that we can see everybody's answer at the same time. If you've got a Padlet board up there on the screen, you can see each individual learner's response to your question or each individual person's idea. And this is fantastic. So we can actually monitor learning more easily too, because we can see everything on the screen. You can give feedback orally in real time, whether the lesson's face-to-face or online, and you don't really need to make any adjustments to your planning for this. A really useful tool for delivering lessons face-to-face and online with no adaptation at all is Nearpod. This is really cool. It allows you to create or import slides with a range of media and add interactive activities too. So for example, you can see here a video presenting the language of illness for our primary learners. They watch the video, then complete a multiple choice quiz to show understanding. Then they complete a gap fill task to practice using the language. And then they answer an open-ended question such as, like, maybe what can you see in the picture? They record themselves describing the picture, and then you can listen to it and provide feedback on it. And you can work through this material together in a face-to-face classroom with you controlling the slides and monitoring and providing support. Or learners can work through them in their own time at home with little or no change. So this is actually, it's a lovely tool for enabling you to do that. Okay, we're getting close to time, so I'm going to speed up just a little bit to get through these next few slides. Planning for the worst case scenario. So I think the worst case scenario is probably something like everybody has to go back to totally online teaching and learning, and perhaps maybe not even able to do online classes where it's all asynchronous work. So we might need to adapt some things in that scenario. Community building can still involve sharing and responding. For example, we can get learners to share descriptions of things they've got that are special to them via Padlet, and then maybe respond to at least two other people's posts, maybe asking or answering follow-up questions. Collaborative tasks that involve discussions may need to move to online forums or be turned into more monologue type activities. This secondary activity here, for example, is tricky as a question and answer activity, but learners could provide information about themselves, then listen to their partner's recording and fill in the table, which they then photograph and submit, and their partner can say if they filled it in correctly. So there's ways of doing it, there's ways of staging those communicative activities so they can still be done. Last one. If you're using a physical book and everything goes asynchronous, checking work can become a little bit more difficult. One solution is for learners to take a photo of their work and send it to you or upload it to the LMS. If they're using an ebook where you can't see their responses, they can also take a screenshot and send that. And you might be able to provide, as we mentioned before, individual tutorials for learners via social media or email or phone to check on progress and to provide support. So we've actually come to the end of the session. We've got a little bit of time for Q&A, but the overall message here is that by asking learners to complete some activities asynchronously and by asking them to use digital tools in our synchronous lessons, we can build in flexibility to adapt to different teaching situations more quickly and easily, and still continue to monitor and to provide feedback on learning. And this also can really help your learners to develop skills for working autonomously on a range of different independent and collaborative tasks. And it can help them to become more effective learners for the future too. So it's not all bad. Okay, I'm going to stop there, George. I'm wondering if there's any questions already in the Q&A.
I'll try and group them so we can.
We've got about 5 minutes, so let's have a look.
One very quickly keeps popping up. What is LMS? I know you covered it, but in 7 seconds.
LMS is a learning management system. It's like a platform which brings lots of things together in the same place, which means you can communicate, share documents, do quizzes and all kinds of stuff together. And probably in most of your LMSs now, you have an online classroom function as well where you can do video calls.
Excellent. And Screencast-O-Matic, do you have any experience with Screencast-O-Matic? We've got lots of questions about that and generally about recording your own video screen.
Yeah, so recording your own video screen, it doesn't matter what tool you use. The important thing is to think about not the tool you're using, but why you're giving the feedback. So like basically screencasting tools record your screen. So if you've got a slide or a piece of work someone submitted or a photo or something like that, then you can talk and give feedback. The inclination when you do that, because the student's not right in front of you, is to give too much feedback or to give feedback on every single grammar error or, you know, all those things that we try and avoid normally. So try and stay within your normal system of giving feedback. Look for a couple of areas to give feedback on. Don't overwhelm your learners.
I think it is a really nice approach as well because you're integrating skills with your feedback as well. And giving
totally, totally. And the power of the human voice in that feedback, not just some comments, because they do appreciate comments on written work, of course they do, but you know, the actual fact that another human has sat down and taken the time to analyze your work and understand where your problems and your strengths are. Please give feedback on strengths, but it's really motivating for most learners.
And one from Paula, are there any synchronous activities that are your favorites for adult learning that you would recommend?
Synchronous activities for adult learners. I'm thinking of primary at the moment. For adult learners, I think adult learners enjoy fun things just as much as younger learners. And I think I've said this before, probably in another webinar, but getting in an online classroom, a synchronous online classroom, getting people to share things from their environment that are okay to share, you know, nothing personal, like too personal. They're getting to share even like photographs or special objects or maybe the cake they just made. It's such a fantastic way of stimulating conversation. You don't get that kind of like, oh, what do I say? People are really engaged and they want to communicate and they want to know. So they're really motivated to use the language. So things like that, I think, are fantastic.
Lovely. Back down to primary, how would you suggest assessing 165 grade one students? They're getting more difficult, Ellen. I started with the easy ones.
Okay, so in an online environment, so I'm gonna sort of quarter it a little bit here. In an online environment, obviously it's not gonna be like a summative assessment. So it's gonna be some kind of formative assessment, I hope, with this. What I would do is I would do a little bit of learner training around the value of assessment and what assessment is for. And I might share that also with the parents to tell them that this is, you know, the number that your child gets out of this test is not really very important. What the most important thing is that me as a teacher and your child, the learner, understands what they can do well and where they can improve or what new things they can learn. And then I would do some kind of online quiz and perhaps some kind of open activity as well, maybe even a little speaking task or a little written task, but very small. And I would take the automated results of the online quiz to save me time. So that would give me the results and identify the areas that the students need to do more practice on as a group. And I would use the open responses to find a little bit more individually about those learners and where the problems are. But that's a large number. I hope you have a reasonable amount of time to be able to assess those learners. Really, that's, you know, sort of it needs to be done over time. So a little bit often is probably better than a great big summative test at the end. You'll probably get a better picture and you'll be able to design your learning better over the time that you're teaching them.
Lovely. We have a few again about rubrics and assessment criteria, which I'll start to answer. All of our speaking and writing assessment criteria is published in the teacher's handbooks at each level.
That's right.
My colleague Victoria Pena and I have done a few sessions which are on our YouTube with success criteria, where we've written the criteria down to level. Keeping it as close to the original as possible. That's a really nice way to help structure peer assessment activities. And as Helen was saying, making sure the students are aware of what their strengths are, where they need to improve.
Exactly. Parents and learners, I think that's important as well in this online environment, that parents understand that the purpose of assessment. There's a really good point there as well, George, that there is a Young Learner Assessment webinar recording on our YouTube channel on Cambridge English TV. So that might be another really good source of information, more than I can give in 30 seconds, on how to assess your larger group of learners. Are we done for time? Are we okay?
I don't know. I suppose they'll just cut us off or step in.
Let's do one more.
One more. Sorry. It's gone a bit slow. My chat's gone a bit slow. How do we motivate younger learners, some of whom are quite camera shy and don't like to show themselves?
Yeah, so this is a really interesting question. It's one of those things where maybe you don't actually need them to have the camera on all the time. And maybe you can do something with, for example, puppets or objects where the focus is not on the face of the learner, but the object that they're holding up. So the usual kind of things that you might use with learners might also work effectively for you in an online environment. So it's that kind of displacement. It's removing them from the focus of attention. Maybe you've got your puppet or your object here, and that's what the other learners are looking at. So it helps them to use the language, perhaps with puppets as well, in a non-direct way, so they can talk about what the puppet's doing or what the puppet likes, all that kind of stuff.
Lovely. I think we should probably wrap up now.
I think
thank
we should
you
probably
all
wrap
very
up.
Much.
Thank you so much. I'm going to go and read all the chat comments that I couldn't see now. I'm really interested to see what you wrote. But thank you so much for your participation and for listening. And I hope you have a lovely rest of the day or evening wherever you are in the world. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.